So, very good morning to all of you. Professor Gananatha Vesekara, the chairperson of the organizing committee. Professor Tudor Silva and all the, and Mrs. Gananatha Vesekara and all of you. It is strange that I have been asked to introduce Professor Gananatha Vesekara because I am neither a sociologist nor an anthropologist nor a historian. My only qualification is that I have seen and known him for a very long time. That is over, I think about 58 years I have known him. When I came to the university in 1958, he was a young lecturer, very dominant character, sometimes very anti-authority character, and also he was a luminary of the scholars in the university even at that time. He has proved much more now, and it is a very great pleasure that I have been asked to introduce him. And actually this happened because on last Sunday, Professor Tudor Silva and myself, we were on a trip to Katharagama, where he has been working for a very long time, and he is almost the authority of Katharagama, because even the Kapuralas in Katharagama, they don't know some of the rituals, and they ask Professor Gananatha Vesekara whether some of these rituals are done correctly or not. Sunday morning, Professor Tudor Silva and myself, we went to have a bath in the sea bath. So we had a walk and we were talking about the sociology department here, and then suddenly he said that there is going to be a sociology day, and that Professor Gananatha will be addressing you all. And of course I didn't know about it, because now I am retired after 15 years. I don't come to the university very much. So in any case, I said I would like to come to listen to his speech. Then following day, that is on Monday, I got an invitation to introduce, of course, Professor Gananatha Vesekara. I have known him since 1958, as I told you earlier, and at that time he was a great scholar, and also he was a well-known figure, various in both his stature and in his outlook, and his the way he behaved, and he also, I think he got his first class English honors, and also he got a first class student equal to his stature and appearance, most beautiful girl of the university at that time. So she is also here, and now they have been a good couple for the last so many years, I think maybe about 60 years or so. So we are very grateful that he had consented to come and address you all. And as you know, he also got a D.Litt from our university, and he had been teaching in the university from 1965 onwards for some time. But though he got his first class honors in English, one of the characteristics of Professor Vesekara is that he always goes, he doesn't like to follow the beaten track. He wants to get outside of the track and follow his own path. That is, when he got his first class in English, that was the most prestigious thing in the university at the time, to get a first class in English. And when he was invited to be a lecturer here, he refused outright, because he had other plans. And then he did not come to the university, because at that time, the craze of the university scholars, students, after getting a first class, was either to join the university or to become a person in the CCS, Ceylon Civil Service. But I don't think he ever liked that job. So What he did is something quite different. Although he got so many scholarships to go to London and study in Cambridge and elsewhere, he didn't want to go there. His interest was to go to America and study anthropology. So instead of English, he followed the anthropology courses there. Of course, he wrote his MPhil and MA and PhD all in this field. And now we have a superb scholar. He has written so many books. Actually, I have a list of books. There are 8 of his important contributions, all dealing with Sri Lankan, most of them dealing with Sri Lankan culture, and some on international kind of studies, but all on pertaining to anthropology, psychology, and social science, and history, and all kinds of subjects. So, so he wrote his Lantana in Village Ceylon in 1967. It was a work on the study of Lantana in a certain village of Sri Lanka. And then Medusa Seya, another work. His Katargam experiences are mentioned there. I'm just running through this list. Then the Cult of Patini, his greatest work, and he has done a lot of research for that work, and he has engaged himself 20 years to write that book, and it is one of the classics. And also it is recognized as a classic on its own by many scholars, who international scholars as well. And then the another work is Buddhism Transformed, with collaboration with Professor Gombrich in 19, I don't want to give the date. Then the work of culture, symbolic transformation of psychoanalysis and that subject anthropology. Then Apotheosis of Captain Cook. This is another work very important because Professor Gannath Obeyesekara came to be envied by many for writing this kind of work, because it says that Captain Cook, it is generally referred to as cookbook, because he says that Cook was, though generally he is considered as a god by Melanesian or the Polynesian people, he contradicts that. It was not so. So it's a kind of a book which actually the myth of the white persons being sort of deified, he denies that. So it is a work that deals with demythicization of the Western concepts. Or similar is his work on Cannibal Talk. With Cannibal Talk, he introduces that most of the white people consider that outsiders, especially in the East and the West, the Aborigines and others, are cannibals. So he denies that also. Again, it's a kind of a myth that the Westerners have introduced. So this kind of work, and then also Karma and Rebirth, and he wrote this work, and he tries to say that, of course, he has convincingly proved that the idea of karma is found not only in Buddhism, but also not only in the Indian conditions, but also in outside cultures, especially the primitive cultures. So the idea of karma, he says, is a general theme and not a very special theme for India. And also some other books like Awakened Ones, Phenomenology of Visionary Experiences. So when you read his books, you can estimate how much knowledge he has. And in fact, although I am not a sociologist or anthropologist, I have collected the various readings, various articles, and I have a list of 134 articles written by him on various subjects pertaining to Sri Lankan culture, religion, then social change, social conflicts. So when you actually go through this list, Of course, out of this 134, there are a few repetitions as well in the listing, but I think he has written over 100 articles, all pertaining to Sri Lankan culture. So in brief, I don't want to make a long speech because he will make a long speech. So in his approach to sociology, he has used both different methodologies. Sometimes he uses Weberian sociological analytical methodology, sometimes Freudian methodology, and sometimes he uses function and structural methodologies, followed by Evans, Pritchard and others. So that way he is a very, very accomplished scholar, and is now internationally recognized as one of the greatest anthropologists of this century. And also what I have to say is that although he sort of is anti-authority most of the time, he respects the traditions, and he insists that the traditions should be followed, and that is one of the very important things that we gathered from him. And also apart from that, he is a very creative writer, because his writing is exemplary. Because it is, we as students at that time were sort of very much taken by his short, very lucid English expressions. So we used to study his English. And there was another scholar called H.L. Seneviratna, who used to give a lot of information about him. And we had, at that time, the fortune of learning both sides of this anthropological and non-anthropological approaches, because there were scholars in Peradeniya at that time who were doing mostly philological studies, and anthropological studies actually came later, and we were very much taken up by those. And also he, in a way, was also a literary critic. I can still remember one of his articles in Sinhala about Kulasuriyage Puduma Pahana. That is, he has criticized Professor Kulasuriya's opinion about W.A. Silva's novel, because he was at that time working with Professor Sarachandra and all of these people. And this, we were fortunate that this triumvirate of scholars, Professor Gananath Obeysekara, and then Professor Tambaya and Ralph Pieris, all were working together, and we had the fortune of studying some things under them. And so now I think we could invite him to make his speech. And what I have to say finally is that, as one of the Sigiri poets say, from wherever path you go, you have to go to Sigiri. So in the same manner, if you are interested in knowing about the Sri Lankan culture of this period, you have to go through Gananath Obeysekara. He is a person who cannot be avoided. So if it's not for him, I don't think we can interpret the modern Sri Lankan culture without the various reflections by him. So while thanking him, I also invite him to make his speech.